Dr. Majumdar, President, Indian Academy of Sciences, and all the fellows for organizing this tribute to my father on his birth centenary and for giving me an opportunity to represent the family. Today's distinguished speakers have told you about what Satish meant to other people, but I will talk today of the people who deeply influenced him and without whom I think his life would have been immeasurably different. Satish Dhawan was fortunate to be born to a progressive middle-class family. His father, Devdayal, hailed from Dera Ismail Khan, shown here as a picture of pre-independence Punjab. And Devdayal trained for the bar in Lahore. His mother, Lakshmi Khosla, was the daughter of Duni Chand Khosla, who was the chief medical officer of Kashmir, and he had been valued for his service during the serial plague outbreaks in 1905 to 1908. As a judge, my grandfather Devdayal was posted all over undivided Punjab, and after partition was actually involved in attempting the rehabilitation of the millions who were displaced during that terrible fracture. Satish and his siblings were close. I'm showing you here a picture of all of them from around 1950. His older sister, Vimla, was a talented artist. His younger sisters, Primla and Shukla, were both educators. And his youngest brother, younger by 11 years, was a fighter pilot. Shown here is a picture of Primla Lumba and her husband, Satish Lumba, who were very close. In addition to being a teacher, Primla was a committed activist for women's rights and social justice. And she and her husband, Satish Lumba, a trade union leader, were among Satish Dhawan's closest relationships. Tragically, Satish Lumba passed away in 1973 in an air crash, but Pimi lived to the grand age of 94. Inspiring generations of students, activists, scholars, and ordinary citizens to never stop fighting the good fight. The Lahore and Srinagar of Satish's youth were comfortable places for a young man who seemed to have a boundless enthusiasm and motivation set against the backdrop of colonial rule, partition, and the powerful, mesmerizing figures of Gandhi and Nehru. Many have commented in this series of talks on his unusual list of degrees, but I wonder if in fact they represent Satish's search for the right profession. I'm showing you here his certificates from his BA and his MA, in which he got a second class in both degrees. And I wonder, would Satish have been permitted to advance in today's intensely competitive educational environment? In studying engineering, actually, I think Satish may have actually hit his stride, finally finding the thing that made him happy. Even before independence, some far-sighted individuals in government had actually formulated a program for educating young Indians in the best centers for technical and scientific education in the UK and the USA. Based on the Hill report, 1,000 scholarships were awarded to aspiring young Indians, a few shown here in New York City. These young students became a part of the generation that built modern India. They did not know this at the time. They did not know that who they would be, or indeed that they would be remembered at all. Right now, as you can see from this group, a great adventure awaited them. Satish was away at Caltech during partition. The Dhawan family was fortunate to survive intact in the tragic upheaval that tore our country apart. Rodham Narsimha has spoken about Hans Liepmann and Anatol Roshko, who were his close friends. Hans, Anatol, and Satish, three immigrants from Germany via Istanbul for Hans, Ukraine via Canada for Anatole, and India, formed a close bond, and they were friends and collaborators for life. Rodham Narsimha, Satish's student, also became a part of that close group, and you have heard from him about his experience. The mutual regard of Satish, Rodham, and their mentor, Hans Liepmann. I doubt very much that the young Satish, who was at Caltech in 1949, had any idea that his name would be clubbed with the greats of Galsit. In returning to India in 1951, Satish was fortunate to be selected for a position at the Indian Institute of Science. I call these the IISc dream days because he threw himself into his work, and his delight at working with his hands, as he saw it, unseparated from the mind. This delight was shared by the master craftsmen of the Aero Department workshop. Alas, I could not find pictures of them, but I want to mention their names here because these were people with whom Satish worked very closely on a daily basis. Mr. B. Ramaya, Mr. J. Doss, and Mr. Benedict Norona, all of whom worked with Satish to create purpose-built instruments that were vital to his research. As you know, there was very little funding for research at the time, and all of this was done on a shoestring budget. Down here, I show the Aero Department as it is today, much more sophisticated. An early activity that grew out of Satish's commitment to egalitarian values was his participation in the World Federation of Scientific Workers. Shown here is Satish addressing the meeting in Beijing, Science for Peace and the Welfare of Mankind, and meeting with Chou Enlai. So fortunate as he was in his birth family, Satish was also lucky in love. He met my mother, Nalini Nirodi, right outside the aeronautics department in 1955, and they were married soon after. Nalini was also a scientist. She had gotten a PhD in cytogenetics at Washington University. And they settled into life at IISc. IISc was much more than a workplace for Satish, shown here with Nehru, unconsciously perhaps, measuring. So IISc was this paradise for us. It was a place where you could explore. It was unfettered. It was a charmed existence. Shown here is Satish walking from the main building, I think, towards the Aero Department sometime in 1965. So this picture has been shown before. I call this the Sunday discussion group of practical idealists. These were men who met first 50 years ago. This is a picture taken at Amulya Reddy's house in 99, about 50 years after their first meeting. Shown here are Lakshman Rao, M.A. Sethu Rao, A.R. Vasudev Murthy, K. Krishnaswamy, Amulya Reddy, and Satish. I'm afraid I couldn't identify this last person, but these were all people who were inspired by discussions that they had with the polymath D.D. Kosambi, historian, mathematician, philosopher, and which inspired them, I think, in many ways, to each of them work hard in their chosen area, but they never forgot the value of focusing that endeavor on a commitment to a larger cause, be it education, appropriate technology, egalitarian ideals, technology for rural development, etc. Satish retired from IISc in 1981, shown here, flying one of his favorite paper planes. I would like to talk about another grouping of people with whom he had close association and whose shared love of flight brought them into intense contact. And here I talk about not just aeronautical engineers, You've seen this picture as well before. This is Rao Valluri of NAL, also a fellow Caltech graduate, and Raj Mahindra, aircraft designer extraordinaire. Shown here is Group Captain Suranjan Das, who was the test pilot who tested many, many aircraft at HAL and tragically died in testing the HF-24. Down here is shown my uncle, Jeet Dhawan, fighter pilot. Shown here is the Marut, the HF-24 supersonic plane, the first Asian-built fighter plane built at HAL, designed by Kurt Tank, and flown by my uncle, Jeet Dhawan, and other members of the Squadron 220, the Desert Tigers. This picture is from December 5th, 1971, at the forward post in Uttarlai, in the height of the war. 1972, the ISRO challenge, shown here, a picture from a bit earlier, 1969, I believe, of Satish with Vikram Sarabhai and Mrs. Gandhi. Both Sarabhai and Satish believed very deeply that space technologies would help in solving real-world problems, and not only by a need to indulge in humankind's existential curiosities. Life was busy in those early IISc years, but his appointment, Satish's appointment to ISRO, changed many things, since it catapulted him into a whirlwind of activity and expectations at a national level, set on the back of India's aspirations in space. You've seen this picture as well, with Dr. Brahm Prakash and a host of people at a review with Dr. Kalam. And the point I wanted to make with this has also been made before by several of the ISRO chairmen. The culture of ISRO incorporates a very steady and detailed analysis of all failures. The main point is that you cannot have serial successes unless you learn from failure and acknowledge the deep learning that comes from loss. I wanted to show you a handwritten note of Satish's for a lecture that he gave to the Indian Academy on the space program in 1979, and where he emphasizes improved communications, weather satellites, resource surveys, and the great importance of these types of issues for developing countries, and the strategy which was put in place to actually achieve this. His focus was always on indigenous development and peaceful uses. I'd like to focus on a few things which were matters of conscience. As a scientist, Satish was involved in the Association of Indian Scientific Workers, and of course in Pugwash. As a professional, I will touch upon the Nambi Narayan case, and as a citizen, with the Narmada petition. Both Sarabhai and Satish were pragmatic in their understanding of the implications of space science and nuclear energy for military purposes, but I believe both were firmly committed to their peaceful use, leading to their active involvement in the Pugwash conferences on disarmament. Coming to the public defense of Nambi Narayanan, and it's stunning that it has taken this long, a quarter century after he started his fight for justice. This is from just last week's frontline that the report came of a final nail, hopefully, in this terrible injustice that was done to Nambi Narayanan. In the matter of conscience, Satish was also full of admiration for Medha Patkar's selfless struggle to keep the fate of displaced people in our collective consciousness. Perhaps that was refracted through the lens of his own family's displacement in partition. Although they all thrived, many, many millions in our country do not, because of a consequence of displacement. I'd like to end with some reflections on another group of friends, four friends in the post-independence era, Goku, Shivraj, Satish, and Rand. So, to me, when reflecting on my father's life and the group of people whom he knew, they illustrate the fact that when you are in the midst of working life, you have no time to realize that you may contribute in ways that you cannot imagine, and perhaps even in ways that you have no intention of doing. So three of these friends had more standard paths. For example, Goku from Madras to Bristol to TIFR, Shivraj from IISc to Oxford, back to IISc again, Satish from Lahore to Caltech to IISc to ISRO. But Rand wandered the globe in search of adventure in life and science, but ended up back in Bangalore. So here is a picture of the young Goku winning a wrestling shield in 1940. And here is MGK Menon with Mrs. Gandhi in 1970 as the director of TIFR. And remembered, I doubt very much that this young Goku, who planned the neutrino experiment in KGF mine shafts, ever imagined that he would be called upon to lead so many institutions of national importance, and that he would be remembered as the quintessence of sagacity and visionary leadership. I doubt very much that the young Shivraj, who waited at a college function in Wardha to get close enough to the Mahatma to physically touch him as a talisman, would ever have imagined that he would be remembered not only for being a distinguished physicist, collaborator of the great Dorothy Hodgkin, but also for the enormous personal influence he had on championing the cause of rigorous scientific publishing in India. I'm pretty sure that the young Rad, who built and sailed a trimaran from Ipswich to Sydney, the very epitome of adventure, would ever have imagined that he would return to India to head the RRI and be remembered as the creator of a unique institutional model. And of course, I am absolutely sure that the young Satish, who trained at HAL fixing British warplanes in pre-independence India, would have imagined that one day we would have a vibrant, civilian-safe space program with a center named after him. So were there great visionaries and doers only in the era just post-independence? If there's one thing I have realized after meditating on my father's life, it is this. It often seemed to me that the generation who built independent India was more committed and focused than my own, or the current generation for that matter. But this is something of an illusion, since every generation is likely to value the inheritance of problems that are seemingly solved by the previous generation, and to devalue the struggles of people around them. Because those struggles are still in progress. We don't know the end of the stories that we see developing around us. Today, the task is as difficult, if not more so, than the struggle and the emergence of independent India, since those with whom we must disagree with and take issue with are not a foreign colonizing power, but ourselves. A colonial government can have no moral authority, only aggressive strength. And in the end, they must recognize this and leave, as they did. But what of our own ability to ensure dissent and open discussion in our society so that we accommodate divergent views and make it possible for all members of our society to progress, not one set at the cost of others? Satish had a peaceful retirement with grandchildren. In his last research work, in which he claimed no originality, Satish focused on bird flight, using the high-speed cameras and proximity to migratory birds offered by his frequent visits to Lake Pulikat near Sriharikota. In the little book that grew out of his work, he thanked ISRO scientists for their help and the birds for their participation. In his life, Satish studied elements of flight and left a legacy that went beyond aeronautical research and space applications. Thank you all for participating in this remembrance of my dear father.
Thank you very much, Jyotsna. what an afternoon it was. The last 4 hours was just absolutely stunning. I started by saying that I do not have the audacity to say anything on Professor Dhawan, but I'm here only to learn, and I must say that I've learned a great deal. I wish to end this tribute to Satish Dhawan by stating something that Bill Vaughan had once said, and I quote, "Not armies, not nations advance the race, but here and there, in the course of ages, an individual has stood up and cast his shadow on the world." This is Satish Dhawan. I thank all of the speakers today, and it was a great learning experience, and I think a great tribute to the man who changed the destiny of India in some ways. Thank you very much.